you were to be stranded on a random island in the middle of nowhere, how would you react and what would you do to try to get help? It sort of depends on what kind of island it is. If it has vegetation, if I woke up stranded, I'd be all like, hello? To see if I'm alone. Usually if you're not alone, they're, you know, close to you. So realize I'm alone and go, fuck. Because for one, I'm stranded. For two, it's probably hot. For three, it's really sunny and I need SPF 100. So immediately I would probably try to find some shade. Hopefully there's, you know, some type of forest or something so I could go in there. And the first thing I would do is look to see what kind of plants there are, to see if there's anything that looks edible. I would gather things, like fruits and stuff, that I think would be edible. I would have to bring them out to the sand or whatever and just kind of set them there. Go back, get a couple sticks, you know, some sticks, just to light a fire for warmth. But I will also grab a lot of leaves. Leaves, that's very important. Take all that, take it back to where I'm setting up my base or whatever. Because if you burn leaves, it produces smoke. Smoke is, hey, SOS, I'm here, come get me. If you just burn wood, it's not gonna do anything. So wood for warmth, leaves for signal. I would try to build some kind of shelter out of whatever I could. I mean, I'm really creative and I'm pretty resourceful. When I was a kid, you couldn't ground me because there was no taking away my fun, because my fun came from the littlest, simplest things that would be no point in taking away. So yeah, beat the system on that one. So I'm very resourceful. I just need something to protect me from the UV rays. Now with the fruit, I would make my best judgment on which fruits were probably poisonous or not, but if I ended up eating one that was poisonous, then I end up eating one that's poisonous. And I die. Whoops. In fact, I'd probably start a leaf fire before trying the food. If I survive from the fruits, at least I know which fruits are indeed edible. Worst case scenario, because I'm a vegetarian, worst case scenario, if I had to, I would eat an animal. I would go for fish first. Something that's not cute and fuzzy like a bunny. I would try to avoid land animals. Land mammals, land animal snakes even, lizards, avoid that. Just go with the fish. But when it comes to survival, you do what you have to do. Now there's probably a lot of animals in said forest, a lot of dangerous things, probably also a lot of dangerous plants. So I would try my best, but I personally am not afraid of dying. I'm afraid of dying a painful death. So whatever happens, happens. If it ends up being painful, that sucks. If I end up dying, that sucks. But at least I tried, because that is what matters. That's what matters. You work hard, and you take life, and you grab it by the horns like a bull, and you push back. So I try. And, you know, hopefully, if I manage to survive all these other things, my leaf fire will eventually attract a plane, helicopter, something, a boat, something. I would probably also gather rocks and write SOS in the sand, just in case. Do you ship Bildip? No. Do you ship Mabica? No. Do you ship Sanchez? No. When and where did you and Mike meet? Like I said, at Walgreens. I think I was 20 at the time. So we met at Walgreens. I was physically attracted to him. And the more we hung out, the more I was just like, I like this guy. So we were both working at Walgreens though, so we had to pretend that we just had a friendship. Even though in the training video it said it was okay to date the coworkers as long as, you know, you didn't do something nasty-wasty in the bathroom or break room, and as long as your conversations were professional. Which, that's just a duh. That is just a duh. And we were completely professional at work, you know, aside from the jokes that we all shared together with the staff. You know, we were all just pretty, you know, jokety. You know, and we never did anything at work, but the fact that our manager specifically said no dating coworkers made Mike and I go, we really need this job and we don't want to get fired. So even though we're technically not doing anything wrong by company standards, we're gonna have to hide it. So unfortunately, and it hurt me to do so, and I'm so glad I don't have to do it anymore, I had to lie about my sexuality and I had to say about that I was a lesbian to further make it obvious that he and I weren't dating. But that's all over, and I'm glad it's over, because, well, it just hurt. And that was kind of before my code of honor of honesty was fully established, because I was breaking it, and I didn't like it. I really didn't like it, but I'm just glad it's over. How do you come up with all of your ideas for a Raytana fix? Usually it's daydreaming. Usually all my ideas happen, I say daydreaming, because it usually happens if I wake up too early and I'm laying there and I'm just thinking about stuff, or before I fall asleep. After I take my sleeping medication, before I fall asleep, I'm thinking about stuff, and that's usually when things come to me. But a majority of my ideas come from my dreams, my nightmares, and my regular dreams. That's where most of my ideas come from. And when the idea comes to me, like Lotrids, for instance, that was an extremely detailed idea that I was able to take and put into this completely, this huge thing. But it was so detailed that my subconscious did most of the work for me. And, you know, and personal experiences, just things, you know, just wherever, that's where my ideas just come into my head. They just happen. There are sirens outside. I'm losing my voice because I've been talking too much. And how long have you been drawing and writing? What made you want to start writing? I've been drawing since the day I could pick up a writing tool. So, a toddler? I'm not saying I was good. I already went over that. But basically, I've been drawing every single day since then. I started writing when I started learning how to read, because I loved reading, and I had a very high reading level. When I was in second grade, my teacher would not let me pick from the second grade books. She would force me to pick from the fourth grade books. Why? Because the second grade books were not challenging enough. They were too easy to read for me. They posed absolutely no challenge. So she gave me the fourth grade books, and they were a little more challenging, but I enjoyed them nonetheless. When I was in eighth grade, I had, what was it? I believe it was a sophomore reading level when I was in 8th grade. And then by the time I was a freshman, though, it must have escalated really quickly, because they tested me again when I was a freshman, and I was already at a college reading level. So, I loved reading. I was really picky about books, don't get me wrong, I was super picky about books. But I always had a book with me. I've read the Harry Potter series so many times. I was able to finish book one in a day, book two in a day, book three in a day, book four in a couple days, book five in 2 days, book six, admittedly, that took about a week, and I think book seven took a week and a half or two. I don't really remember. I read the first three books of Series of Unfortunate Events in a day, first three in 1 day. When I was bored, I would just read out of one of my school books, like my science book. In eighth grade, I remember specifically, I think a lot in middle school and elementary school, there were shelves of different books that the teachers just had for you to read when you had nothing to do. And I read a lot of good books by just picking them up and giving them a read. I don't remember some of the titles of them. I don't remember a lot. So that's what started me writing. At first, my stories were like picture books, where all of the dialogue was, where all of the story was in dialogue in speech bubbles. I wish I could find some of those, because I had a Powerpuff Girl one. I had a lot of pretty cool stories. And then when I started writing without pictures when I was in sixth grade, oh man, what was that story called? It was Stardust or something. I don't remember what it was, and I don't remember what it was about. And I wish I knew where it was. But I started writing in sixth grade, and it progressed and progressed and progressed. And the more I read, the more I wanted to write. And honestly, I'm a better writer than I am an artist. Like, I'm better at writing than I am drawing. You know, I'm pretty good at drawing. You know, I can work Inkscape and Photoshop. My people look terrible, so that's why I've been using bases lately. But again, I have to alter the bases pretty drastically. I use bases for ponies. The fact that I use bases is really no secret, but it takes me quite a long time to actually, you know, do it the way I do it. I can draw stuff, you know, there are plenty of things that I've drawn by hand, plenty of good things, plenty of mishaps where I've drawn good people, but hands down, I'm a way better writer, and I know there are a lot of my fans and Raytonites that can agree with me. So, any advice for people wanting to be good writers? Read! Read. And don't read stuff on the internet. Don't read stories by people. Like, don't consider reading my stuff reading. Don't consider creepypastas reading. Books, novels, published, professionally written and published books. Read them. Challenge yourself with them. Actually, a lot of my writing techniques have come from Harry Potter, The Golden Compass, the Alex Rider series of unfortunate events, and just other stories that I have picked up these skills because these are professional writers and I have picked up skills. Hell, I learned how to write dialogue because of J.K. Rowling, or Rowling, I never knew how to pronounce it. I knew that how to separate paragraphs properly because of Harry Potter, and that was a huge step in my writing. So if you want to be a good writer, you have to read. And not just you have to read, you have to enjoy it. You have to really enjoy it. The higher reading level you have, the better writer you're going to become. Writing is not something, it's one of those things where yes, you can learn how to do it, but not everybody can learn how to do it. If you're not good at it, I'm not saying don't try, but if you're reading and you have a high reading level and if you're doing all these things and you're working so hard, but it's just not clicking and you're not enjoying it, don't do it. Because writers are one of those things that are kind of born. Now, every single person in my bloodline is an artist of some kind. So I've got it in my blood. But that doesn't mean I haven't had to work for it, obviously. But the fact that it does come naturally, it comes naturally enough for me to want to work at it, to enjoy working at it. That is a passion. You don't want your passion to seem like work. I don't want my art to seem like I'm going to Walgreens every day. So, you know?